So Werner, thanks for being here and being with us. And as we did a little introduction just now, I discovered in a way you're coming home. And so before we start to talk about Amazon and the developments there and the whole space of Amazon Web Services, let's talk about you for 2 seconds. Can you talk a little bit about the journey that brought you here? Because I thought there was a very intriguing twist in your life that put you on this trajectory that's interesting to know.
Yeah, so actually I didn't start computer science until I was, I think, 28, 29, something like that. Before that, I was a radiologisch laborant. So at Antonie van Leeuwenhoek here in Amsterdam. And so I picked computer science, to be honest, not really knowing what it was. Yeah, it seemed like, and this is mid-80s, it seemed like a good career path without really realizing what it was. Turns out, I had a gift for it. Yeah, and so if you look at many of the things that happened in my life, it's sort of stumbling over sort of things that you happen to be good in.
How did you end up at Amazon?
So what happened is that, so I turned out to have to be really good in computer science. And at one moment, Amazon invites me to come and give a talk there. And I go like, really? Amazon? What can it be? It's a bookshop, yeah? What's it gonna be? A web server and a database. You know, how hard can it be? Yeah. Turns out, one glimpse in the kitchen of Amazon made me convinced that this is one of the most advanced technology companies in the world. Yeah, there is not anything in terms of technology that is not happening at Amazon and at massive scale.
Yeah.
Yeah, and whether that is robotics, whether
but before it is we go into the before yeah. we go into technology, okay, you were called by Jeff Bezos, and then you joined. And how many months later were you CTO?
3 months later.
Explain that to me. How does that work?
I don't know. Jeff asked, "Do you want to be the CTO?" And I go like, "He's not going to ask me again next year, is he?" No, so...
What is the secret sauce? What happens?
I don't know. You know, sometimes, you know, you just turn out... So, remember that before this I was an academic. In reality, I think I often call Amazon my first real job. Yeah, before to really become an academic and then sort of get into the extremeness of the technology business that Amazon is in, that was a major shift. It turns out I had good leadership qualities, and I had was an ability to sort of drive engineers where I think they need to go. And I also had a vision about how to get to a particular point. So the thing is that at Amazon, when I joined, and so this is 2004, Amazon was already really good at scaling. But from a practical point of view, things that they had learned over the years how to do, but not from a fundamental principle. Yeah, so in reality, Jeff hiring me was to bring more rigor into the way that we were building our business. We have a tendency to get stuck in the past, in thinking like, this is the way that we were doing things, and as such, we should continue to do that because that's how our business used to run very well. I think having an open mind and seeing how the world around you is changing continuously and being adaptive by it, with it. If there's one thing at Amazon that drives us, it is speed of execution, more than anything else. Yeah, when Jeff started, one thing you have to realize is that Amazon is a technology company. Yeah, when Jeff started Amazon, it wasn't because he wanted to start a bookshop. He was fascinated by the internet and the things that you could only do on the internet that you couldn't do anywhere else. A really good bookshop has 40,000 titles in stock. Yeah? Yet there's millions of books out there.
Yeah.
And so the only place where you could actually build the world's largest bookshop would be online. Yeah. And remember, this is 1994. Yeah? The world as we now know it of online didn't exist.
But when I worked in New York at that time. I was in 1994. I was in New York and I bought the first book in the first year that Amazon went live.
Cool.
And so I was there. But now, just a couple of data on where Amazon is today. I think you hired in the last year 130,000 new employees. That is more than Microsoft has in total around the world today.
We have 100,000 open positions.
You have 100,000 open positions. You have a market cap of $450 billion. Your revenue is about $150 billion. Can you describe just in the image of that growth in 1994 from the initial book to now? What is behind
it? I think so. People management is, of course, the biggest challenge. And by the way, remember that most of the 100,000 that we're talking about is workers in fulfillment centers.
Yeah. Logistics.
But there's a significant portion of this, and there's also engineering. And so where in the past I may have been focused on hiring in Seattle, that's no longer the case.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, we have offices here in Amsterdam, we have them in Rijswijk, we have them in Berlin, we have them in any major city in Europe, we now hiring people. So you go where the talent is instead of asking the talent to come to you. Amazon has been able to grow this fast because we do not have a strict top-down hierarchical structure. Yeah. If you need a top-down hierarchical structure and you need to grow fast, that's not going to scale.
Yeah.
And so, by the way, and this is sort of, in my eyes, these top-down hierarchical structures are unnatural. If you look at nature, yeah, there are no hierarchies. There is a head monkey and all the other monkeys.
Yeah.
There is no lieutenant monkeys or things like that. Yeah. No, there is not.
So you can become a CTO in 3 months.
That's how it works. No. So I strongly believe in self-organizing systems. Where if you hire the right people, you can sort of decentralize your organizations and let teams be in charge of their own destiny.
But what is the compass behind Amazon? What makes it, how come they all run in the direction that makes it so successful? What is that?
Well, mostly because I think you have to have a strong culture. I think you have to have culture plus a set of values. So I think innovation is culture, organization, and technology. So the technology side is the AWS piece. We don't need to talk about that. Culture is all that we can do later. The culture is all around Amazon aims to be the Earth's most customer-centered company and allow that to come back in every piece of our organization where we do this.
Can I challenge you on that? Because it is something that we all aspire for, putting the customer first. How does Amazon do it? Really, what is the how do you make it extra?
No, so you make sure you let it come back anywhere where you operate. So, for example, product development at Amazon is a process called working from the customer backwards. There's four sets of documents that you create for every product or every thing we want to do. Let's keep that a bit vague there. So you start off with writing the press release. No, this is not a press release that will go out.
Yeah, the end goal.
You write the press release. And why? Because in the press release, given that it has to go to journalists, it has, in very clear and simple terms, you describe exactly the kind of product that you're going to build. And then you write the FAQ document. So it's basically the 10 or 20 or 30 questions that people may ask about your product.
Yeah.
And again, on those two documents, we sometimes iterate 10 to 20 times before it is really clear what you're going to do. Then you write two more set of documents. One is how are my customers going to use it? So basically the UX document and parts of the user manual around glossary and terms and things like that. So at the end of that, you have four sets of documents that exactly describe the product that you're going to build for your customers. And so you do that from a customer working backwards perspective. This is before the engineers even get a chance to start developing things. It does mean that we don't allow engineers to build anything else than exactly that.
Yeah. Now, where is Amazon going? Where is this leading us?
I could tell you, but I have to kill you.
Well, let me do something to you. Let me ask the audience whether they know. Who knows what this is? There you go. One, two, three.
Oh, a few there.
What is this?
Okay, so that's the Echo. This is the Echo Dot. It's the smallest version of the device that we've built. And actually, in my eyes, the device was just an example how to use voice. Yeah. So there's a story that goes behind this. The story is that we have been building our compute interfaces based on the capabilities of the machinery that we have.
Yeah.
Screen, keyboard, mouse, finger, maybe. Yeah. And so it is the interfaces has all been driven by the capabilities of the machine instead of, is this really how we would like to communicate? Yeah, listen, you know, this is not a Slack channel where we're chatting here.
We're not typing.
No, we're not typing here, we're talking. Yeah, and so voice and is the natural way of communicating. Now, this device is just an example device. What sits behind it is called the Alexa Voice Service. That sits in the cloud. This device is just has this one is actually the cool one because it doesn't have the big speakers with it. But it does listen to your voice and it listens to wake words and then can react to anything that it is that is there. At this moment, I think it is already 10% of search. At this moment, is voice-driven search.
Yeah,
and the expectation is that in 4 or 5 years from now, 80% of the way that we were interacting with our systems will be through voice.
Yeah, so forget the computer in terminal, forget the fingerprinting on the iPad, it's this.
It's not only that, it is thinking about digital systems in a different way, thinking about in a human-centric way instead of a compute-centric way. Yeah. So again, the success of this digital system is not sort of the machine learning fanciness behind it, it's the human interface that you give it.
So you describe an extreme customer orientation, you describe an agile way of working, teams thrown it with a clear target in mind, to describe clearly, and a boldness to it. Now you're launching this big Amazon Web Services, which is the new branch of Amazon. Can you describe, because that will infect all of the lives of the people in this room.
Yeah, I think probably many of you are customers of AWS. Can I see your raise of hands there? Yeah. In early 2000, we had opened up the catalog through an API for other people to use.
Yeah
so basically, that was popular in those days. You just put an API on it and see what kind of new innovation is going to happen. Turns out, quite a few companies were built and that was using the Amazon catalog data, basically, so that's the information for products. That they're using that data and built very new innovative companies, comparison shopping, all sorts of things. Turns out, when we looked at them, all of these companies, once they became successful, they all started to stutter in their execution. Why? Because suddenly they had to get investment, they had to hire IT people, and mostly they started to stutter because, and the investment was necessary, to buy massive compute power. And we looked at that, thought that, yeah, but we solved that for ourselves already. Can't we just, can we take a few of the capabilities that we have within Amazon and make them available for everybody else? So when we started thinking about opening up our own infrastructure for others to use, we also thought about a radical different business model to go with it.
Yeah,
mostly because we wanted our customers to be in charge. What does it take to become the world's most customer-centric IT vendor? Which means that you have to give control to your customers. Yeah.
So when we go there, what is there? Because this is all about this cloud, the cloud services, and for a bank, that is the new space to go. Which parts of the CEOs in this room that run businesses ranging from energy to consumers to upstream, downstream, medical, where will this cloud not be relevant?
Not be relevant? I think it's relevant anywhere. So Nick Carr wrote an article for Harvard Business Review, was it 15, 20 years ago? It's called IT Doesn't Matter. And he didn't mean that IT didn't matter. It's just that at basic levels, IT is not a competitive differentiator. If you all have to do the same thing, if you all have to do the same level of IT, it is a wasted effort to put your best people on there. And so I think, the kind of things that cloud allows you to do is really focus on the speed of innovation.
So can I go to the following, where, because you have done a revolutionizing of an industry in itself, and out of that built the web services business as a service to others. And you're now advising companies on how to digitally accelerate. If you now look, let's dream ahead. Is there any industry where there would not be, at the end of the tunnel, you're now advising companies, you're building sometimes bookstores. There is a merger of digital and the real physical space. Yeah. Many of these industries are in the physical world with old distribution. Where is this going? When the end state of web services is fully enabled, we're fully digital. Where does the physical come back in? What is your view on that?
Well, as you know, we just bought a grocery store. I think...
Is that the end state? Or is it an experiment?
No. So I think for us, it's easier to think the inverse about how physical companies are thinking. So many of the ones that have physical stores think, how can we digitally enhance what we're doing? For Amazon, it's the other way around. It's sort of, we are already digital. How can we have a physical presence that sort of enhances what we can do for our customers? And so I think there's many things that we, in terms of technology-wise, can still do to sort of enhance the experience. I think the Amazon Go store is a good example of another experiment. So basically the Amazon Go store is where you can walk into, you can grab any product from the shelf, put it in your bag and walk out. And we'll automatically charge you. Is that, and as such, you know, technology drives this. And so can we build systems like that? Can we enhance people's lives like that? If you look at actually grocery shopping is an interesting thing. Much of our grocery shopping is repeat buys. We walk through the store, we know exactly where to find the cereals, we know exactly where to find the toothpaste, and we get annoyed if actually the store moves them. But in essence, most grocery shopping is a repeat buy. If things are repeat buys, that's great to be automated.
Yeah, and so there's another theme in your story, which is not only customer extreme customer focus, it is the way of working. It is also that you are, in essence, a platform, and that you can look at, if you take Frans' story about medicine and healthcare, or the earlier conversations about the future of this planet, will be platforms. So your recommendation could also be seek platforms, or is that not the right conclusion?
And let me not use the Philips example in this particular case, but for example, General Electric has... So one moment, Jeff Immelt, the now departing CEO of General Electric, said, one night you go to bed as a manufacturing company, the next morning you wake up as a software and analytics company.
Yeah.
And so they are providing their analytics not only, so for all the energy company customers, for example, the massive gas turbines. So they're providing analytics internally, they're providing it to their customers, but they're now also providing it to their competitors.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I've seen this is something that you see happening over and over again, where the unique capabilities of some companies allow you to build platforms to allow others to be successful. So, so Lando, for example, is a pretty good e-commerce company here in Europe, run on AWS. Netflix, probably the biggest competitor there is Amazon Video On Demand. Yeah, both run on exactly the same platform.
Can I end at DNA?
Yeah.
And let's suppose, and I know the room is full of CEOs and board members, and they all have their career behind them in a sense, but still have got a way to go, but they also have children. So let's suppose their kids would be in this room, and they would be in the generation of, say, 24. What would you recommend to their kids? And because you have made this huge shift in your lives, we're moving to the digital era. What is your recommendation to the next generation?
I don't know. I think that's so... Don't get stuck in doing one thing. Yeah? I think if I can look back at my own career, if you want to call that, I never got stuck in one particular way. If I could have remained a radiologist laborant forever.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mostly because that was the choice that you made when you happened to be 21. But I think doing a reboot often and frequently, I think, is healthy. Yeah? And so also continue to look at sort of the path that you've taken, not only as an individual, but also as a business. Yeah? The fact that 20 years ago you were really good in selling product X, Y, or Z doesn't mean that it's happening to today. And I think your business is probably one of the biggest examples there, where many of the financial services organizations have to really reinvent themselves to become more customer-centric.
Yeah.
And we talked about this earlier. Who here loves their bank? Look at that.
I love my bank.
Who here loves their mobile provider? Who here loves their cable company? Look at that. If your customers hate you, you're in a really bad business.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. That's a very nice close. Can we get it a little bit more uplifting here? Is it a...
But I think the great thing is, about companies like Rabobank and others is that you are realizing that sort of you need to reinvent yourself to become more customer-centric, because otherwise customers will walk away.
There you go. And that's a good thing to realize.
And now I think it's still hard to switch banks. If it would be easier to switch banks, customers would be voting with their feet.
Yeah, there you go. Now, I wanted to go to the kids in the room first, because they might have the change in them that you have seen. Because you've now met many CEOs in your ways of advising the Amazon Web Services. Do we have it in ourselves, and can we do this, or is this a next generation thing? And what is that DNA that we need?
I don't know, that's hard to... I met with the recently with the CIO of the Border Protection Agency in the US. This, by the way, these guys have a massive hard job. Fingerprints, their IT systems are outer-worldly. Yeah. And he says, I really would like to move to the cloud, but I can't because all my senior architects are 55 and older. And he says, the only way that I can really revolutionize my IT systems is by promoting them away to another agency. Mm. So
that's the way.
Yeah, no. But the realization that sort of you have to have the right people to be able to actually do this transformation. Is that the next generation? I don't know. I don't see myself as the next generation. But I believe that there is still... with the right mindset and the right openness in terms of being susceptible to sort of new things that are happening, I think we can build lots of cool stuff.
Thank you very much for your time. Thanks for coming, Werner.
Thanks, guys.